still in here talking, you know, so y'all understand what it's like. So Jesus was trying to get them, would y'all please get on the boat because I want to go up and pray. So, but they were standing around talking about what had happened, and so it says in verse 22, and when he had sent the multitude away, in other words, when he had finally got them to get in the boat, he went into the mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone because he wanted that quiet time to be talk to the Father. Amen? And it says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves from the wind, for the wind was contrary. And on the other night, we was talking about some of this, and I told Elder, I said, Elder, that's part of the scripture that I was going to talk about, but the one we was talking about was in another gospel. But when I read about it, it says that how that the boisterous wind, Jesus had already told them to go to the other side. So, you know, that meant they was going to get there. But, you know, Satan is the prince of the air. And so he was trying to block them from getting over to the other side. So the storm came up, because then when I thought about it, okay, why would Satan try to hinder them from getting on to the other side? Because beforehand, he had already, the miracle had taken place that he had fed the 5,000. And then when they got to the other side, then here come the enemy again with the people. You know, they was talking about nothing, and about the disciples not washing their hands, you know, before they eat, and you know, just little petty stuff, still trying to hinder. But then when the woman daughter was demon possessed, yes. And so Jesus healed them. So I thought about it, you know, whenever situations when God, right before God want to bless, the enemy don't stir up. And so, because I said, why was so much turmoil going on? Because before it happened, it was a blessing, and afterwards, it's going to be a blessing. So he always tried to hinder. And so in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a spirit. And they cried out for fear. Because straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer. It's I. Be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. So the question is, my mind was, why did Peter want to walk on? You know, why did he want to walk on the water? Why did he want to come to Jesus? And then when I read about it, I thought about he had been with Jesus and he saw all the things that Jesus had done. So if you're walking with Jesus, he healed in the sick. And he feeding the 5,000. Wouldn't you want to come where he was at?
Yeah.
You know, so man, he had a need for Jesus to do something for him. So he wanted to come where Jesus was. He longed for him. You know how sometimes you can be in prayer and you just long for the presence of the Lord to fill your spirit, and you want that quiet time where God can speak to you. Amen. And so he wanted to come where he at. But first of all, we got to notice that Peter asked. He asked Jesus to call him out. Then he waited for the Lord answer. He didn't, when he bid him to come, he didn't just jump out the door when he saw him. He asked him. And then he waited on the answer. And then the Lord allowed him to come. And then next he obeyed when Christ said, come. Then he obeyed. So sometimes we got to find ourselves asking, then wait, and then obey. We got to ask God. And so I thought about why did the Lord call Peter out the boat? Because it was other disciples that was there. But Peter was the only one that asked. the Lord. And after Peter saw his will and asking the Lord for permission, he didn't just jump out the boat. Like I said earlier, he waited on what God, he was waiting on the answer. So sometimes we be in prayer and we ask God, we can't go with the first thought that come in our mind, because that ain't always the Lord speaking to us. A good idea is not always a God idea. So sometimes you got to be patient. And sometimes your wait may be a month. It may be 2 months. It may be 3 months. It may be even a year. But if you know you asked him, you got to wait on the answer of God. Amen. You can't just assume just because you have a good, because I have had a lot of good ideas. And I have acted on some of my good ideas, but I found out later it was not the best thing for me. Amen. So you have to find yourself waiting. So that's what people did. He asked and then he waited and then he obeyed. But when it says in verse 30, but when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried now saying, Lord, save me. A lot of times we'll hear people take it from a point that when he looked around the situation, he began to sink. But I look at the fact that he had enough nerve to step out there when all the rest of them are sitting in the boat. Now sometimes you may step out there and situations may come up, but at least you went out there. Peter went out there when all the boys back looking at him, and then, but he obeyed God because God told him to come, and he's on the word of God. And so sometimes, hallelujah, we got to find ourselves stepping out on the word of God, on the things that God tells us to do. And so we can't be afraid of wondering what people gonna think or what, and what if I fall or what, but you got to have the faith to know that Jesus said, come. And then when he found himself falling and sinking, and then he cried out, he said, Lord, save me. Save me. Save me. And so again, Peter asked. He asked the Lord to save him. He didn't just stand on the water and go down and drown. He cried out and he asked, Lord, save me. Lord, save me. And then he said, immediately. The moment he asked and asked God to save him, the Bible said that Jesus stretched out his hand and he called him. He didn't allow him to go down. He didn't allow him to go down because he asked. And God done for him what he asked him to do. Amen. So I don't know about y'all, but I need the Lord to save me. You know, a lot of times I don't repent and I don't ask the Lord. I don't ask the Lord to come into my life. And he has done just that. But it's situations that arise in my life, I still have to say, Lord, save me. You know, I remember when I was living in Chicago and going to Pastor Hen. I'm trying to move kind of fast because I don't want to make y'all late for y'all service on the day. But this is good to me. You know, I remember I was going to Ella Hinton's church. And we was, you know, y'all know the story. My sister had witnessed to me and, you know, involved in some things I raised to do. And, whoo, Jesus. And my sister kept coming by the house and Karen, I want you to go to church with me. Yeah, all right. Yeah. And then she come back and I said, oh, here she come. She come back. Y'all know about the wet towel down at the door?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't have to say no more. So, I said, Lord, let her stay on the outside. Open the door. I ain't opening the door. But she just kept coming. She kept coming. She kept coming. So I made up my mind, okay, I'm going. Because if I go with you this time, she had promised me I'm going to leave you alone. But my mistake, not knowing that she had fasted a whole week that the Lord would save me. So that was what she was asking from God. And me and my little smart self, I just thought, okay, I'm going to go to church so she leave me alone. So I remember going to Ella Hinton's church. And I sat all the way in the back. Y'all following me? I was sitting all the way in the back of the church because I didn't want to be bothered. I didn't know that the word of God was going to come all the way in going to service, and I tell y'all, I do not to this day know how I got up. When I got up, you know, I had a lot of things in my life that was wrong. Hallelujah, Lord. A lot of things that was not wrong. I had a lot of stuff strapped onto me that I know wasn't right, that I wasn't supposed to be doing. My mother didn't raise me to do drugs, but I was doing them. My mother didn't teach me to run the street and do clubs, but I was doing them. And so I had all these different things. I'm going to come out of this stuff here. But then as I was running to the altar, woo, hallelujah, all these weights that I had on me, hallelujah, I had pain in my left, in my life. I had hurt. So I put that on the altar, hallelujah, hallelujah. Woo, Jesus. Found myself, I had sickness in my life. I wasn't sick at that time. I hadn't had cancer at that time, but I had a sick of mind. My mind was messed up, so yeah, I was sick. And then I had unforgiveness in my heart that done me wrong. People that I thought should have loved me had rejected me. But then I had to bring that to the altar. I had to leave that on the altar. I had drugs, like I was snorting coke. I was doing masculine. I was doing acid. And all these things I had to bring to the altar. Hallelujah. I had alcoholism in my life. I knew people that was on alcohol. And I had to bring all these things to the altar. And I just kept coming to the Lord. I was a liar. I wouldn't tell you the truth if you paid me to tell you the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I had to bring that alcohol. I was a thief. I remember one time I went, me and my daughter, we went shopping in and ooh, Jesus. Hallelujah. And you know, you kind of pick up stuff that don't belong to you. And I remember I was a halter. I had on a halter top of these little shorts because I believe if God gave it to you, you ought to show it. And I was out shopping. Hallelujah, my daughter. She grabbed me by my halter top right here and she pulled me down. And I was exposed all in the street. I tell you, the devil make you look like a fool. When you in the street, he'll make you, he'll bring you to an open shame. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So I had all these strapped on to my life. But then one day I just cried out to the Lord. I said, Lord, save me. Hallelujah. Woo, hallelujah. I cried out to the Lord. I said, save me. Hallelujah. I need you to save me. I need you to turn me around. When I'm looking at my daughter, Wakanda at 5 years old, instead of her trying to tell us or learn about her ABCs or telling us what she's done in school, we called her one time sitting with some marijuana paper, trying to put some ashes in the marijuana paper and trying to roll it up. I said, look what we're teaching her. Look what she's teaching her. Hallelujah. So I said, Lord, save me. Hallelujah. Teach me how to be a mother. Teach me how to be a wife. Hallelujah. So sometimes we need God to save us from the situations we're in. We think we know what we're doing. I had said earlier, know it all. You know, ooh, the devil will fool us. I don't care where you are in your life. If you up high and you making money, you still need God. Hallelujah. If you middle, what they call middle class, whatever that is, you know, I guess that you got maybe $200 or $300 in the bank, you still need God. The Bible says you are nothing without him. And if you broken than broke, you still need God. Hallelujah. Because without him, you are none. I don't care what your status is in life. You need the Lord to save you. Hallelujah. You need the Lord to deliver you from whatever situation you're in. And so when I came to the Lord and all these things began to drop off, you know, they sing the song that when I look at my hands, they look new. I looked at my feet and they get it too. I mean, that's a true statement. That's a true statement. I don't know how it worked. I don't know how it happened. But some kind of way God got on the inside of me. Woo, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God got on the inside of me and he began to work on the inside. And see, when Jesus get down on the inside, he expands himself inside of you. And so he pushes out all those things that you can't do yourself. Hallelujah. He began to expand within you. And you know, when things in my life. And before I knew it, I said, oh my God, I didn't want those. So I could sit around people that done those things and they were still offering to me. I just said, no thanks. I said, thank you, but no thanks. And you know, they would look at me like, what is wrong with her? But God had done something on the inside of me. And then when I had to watch everything I did, God took away the desire. And he would change your life today. Hallelujah. My God, if you want to be changed. And only thing you have to do is just say, Lord, save me. Hallelujah. Your situation, it may not be what your neighbor's situation is, but I guarantee you, whoever you sitting by today, they got a problem. I don't care who they are. They got something in their life that they need the Lord to save them from. It ain't got to be sin. It can be a weakness. It can be you got your children up before the Lord. You got your grandchildren up before the Lord. But you need the Lord to help you.
Thought it was. So they had to make a U-turn.